Okay. Well, that's a very common one where you see people literally spin the glider out of the sky and crash into the ground. This is a combination of gear and training. So they didn't have any proper training and the gear was absolutely horrible. And it's very common. It happens over and over and over. Actually, a guy just died on a Black Hawk again. Same thing, spun his glider. Now, why? So how? I mean, this has nothing to do with the real actual sport where people get proper gear, which would be like a flat top and a dominator, I gotta say it specifically, and you get super training. So there's very specific things. One, let's start with the gear. The people that spin gliders, generally the gliders don't handle for crap. So it's real pig gliders. It can happen to like certified beginner class gliders. Like you take a glider that's like DHV1 or ENA or AFNOR standard. Now, a lot of those gliders, the performance is so terrible. They're such total pigs. They just don't handle for crap. The performance is horrible. So what happens is somebody tries to make it turn and they pull more and more brake, expecting it to turn faster, but the glider literally spins out of the sky before it gives them the desired turn. So one of the reasons the Dominator is so incredible is not only does it have the highest level of safety, so you've got the highest certification rating, but it also has the best performance by far. So if you start yanking a brake on a Dominator, it's going to turn so fast you stop pulling brake because it gave you the desired turn. So naturally, if it turns quickly, you're not going to continue pulling more and more brake. So one is gliders that have horrible performance that don't do what people tell them. Now, another huge part is certifications. So people think, oh, it's a certified glider, so yeah, it's not supposed to do that. Well, all those certifications go right out the window if you hook it to a paramotor that does not have certified height hook-in points. Boom, gone. So all that work the glider companies did and the safety ratings did to try and make a glider stall and spin resistant, poof, right out the window. Now, how's that work? Your certified height hook-in point, there's a specific distance from the seat board of how high that hook-in point is from your seat. So if I take my brake and I bury my brake, well, with certified height hook-in points, you're only going to pull about 14 inches of brake. But if you raise those hook-in points and I pull brake, I can now pull 4 feet of brake. So all of that work that they did to make the glider not spin with a certified height hook-in point just goes right out the window if you hook it to some horrible paramotor like Parajet or Blackhawk or Fly Products that doesn't have certified height hook-in points. You fly a Nirvana, something like that, you may think you've got a certified glider, but all of that safety, poof, right out the window. So you combine that together, and then of course skills. So if the glider doesn't turn so well and is a total pig, as we call it, because the performance is terrible, and you don't have a certified height hook-in point, so a newbie starts pulling more and more brake expecting it to turn, well, the glider spins before it turns. And then of course the third part of that is skill and training, which you can't just tell someone, oh, don't pull brake. It just doesn't work because you're trying to make the glider maneuver and you're trying to explore naturally what a glider will do. And of course, you see other videos of people do something and you expect a glider should be able to make a decent turn. And so you get someone that doesn't have training that goes out and tries to get it to turn and they don't have that feel built in. Because super training is the only school in the world where people are actually trained. I mean, it sounds weird, but yeah, super training is the only school in the world teaching people. There you go. Prove me wrong. Because training is building that feel and reflexes and feeling what's happening. So it's super training. You're talking a school where you're going to get anywhere from 25 to 80 hours of practice with the glider before you even took your first flight. And so if you're kiting for 25 to 60, 80 hours, you're going to stall and spin the glider over and over and over. And day one, your glider's almost upside down more than it's upright. And then day two, you stop spinning it quite so much. Day three, you start to, you know, just barely start to feel, oh, hey, if I pull that much, bam, that's where stall point is. And this is all on the ground before you've got the glider fully loaded where it's going to be completely stall resistant or a lot more stall resistant. And by day four, day five, day six, day seven, all day, every day, you're practicing with the glider. You've spun it, you've stalled it over and over and over to where not only do you get a feel for how much pressure is too much and where it breaks into that stall, but you also learn to react to it. So another thing you can see in videos of brand new super students is you see if they did stall the glider, their hand immediately, instantly reacts the second they feel it go mushy and they put their hand back up. In which case, a super safe glider like the Dominator instantly recovers and just keeps on flying, doesn't care. Even if you could stall it or spin it, if you felt it and reacted to it correctly and instinctively, it would immediately recover anyway and not break into that stall or spin. So that feel is absolutely critical that you learn that on the ground, because it's exactly the same in the sky. On the ground, if you get that massive amount of practice from hours and hours and hours, which can only be done on a beach in wind, you're not going to get those hours inland unless you take years to do it. So you've got to get all of those massive hours of practice learning that feel of how much pressure it takes to spin that glider and to instantly recover from it. By the time you get super students to the point where they can literally kite all day without ever, ever, ever losing control of the glider or spinning it or stalling it or, you know, taking collapses, then and only then do they fly. So before they ever even take their first flights, they literally have all of these hours and hours of practice with every detail of glider control worked into reflexes and feel and response. And there's more to it, because now weight shift is another critical factor. If you don't weight shift correctly, so one of the huge things you'll see at super training, you just won't see at any other school, almost no other instructors can even do it, is just things like reverse kiting, no hands. You know, look at videos. Either other instructors can do it or they can't. I mean, try and find a video of, say, like Tucker Gott or some of these other people, Aviator PPG or Blackhawk. Show me one single video of any of these people doing something basic, like just reverse kiting no hands or kiting up a vertical wall, where you build that feel of that loading of the glider, where you can produce the lift you need, but have that feel and understanding where the stall point is. They can't do it and can't teach it. They have absolutely no clue. So you might see someone like Tucker Gott is a good example. Maybe he got in the air hundreds of times and you go, oh, now I'm the expert, I can explain. The problem is he doesn't have even the most basic skills, so he doesn't understand things like that, which are absolutely critical. So if you do not weight shift correctly, you're not just wrong, you're backwards. So if that glider falls, let's say you're reverse kiting and the glider falls this way, well, this riser is becoming shorter than this riser. That means it's now telling the glider to go that way. And so that means you are weight shifting the glider into the ground. If I now pull the other brake, well, how do you spin a glider? You weight shift one way and you pull brake the other way. That's how you spin a glider. If you want to flat spin a glider, that's how you do it. So if you don't teach someone to weight shift properly, you didn't just teach them wrong, you literally taught them backwards, because it's absolutely critical you do it. Now, most commonly, these happen against a torque. So you'll see if a paramotor torques to the right, prop turns one way. Actually, prop turns this way, and the and it torques the other way. So it would torque. So the prop's going counterclockwise, and so the motor would torque to the right. So if you've got a right torquing motor and they didn't learn anything about weight shift, or they simply don't have proper gear where you can do it, like a unit like the Scout, which is horrible because you just don't have crap for weight shift ability to be able to weight shift correctly. So if you hit full throttle and the unit torques to the right and then you pull brake to turn left, well, now you're setting yourself up for a spin. So if you don't have the right glider, the glider doesn't handle properly, or you don't even have a certified glider, so it doesn't even have the stall and spin resistance, the higher the class rating, generally the shorter the brake range. And you get into like super high-end acro gliders that are totally uncertified, or Hoaxflex death trap gliders they call reflex that are totally uncertified, you could have a brake range as short as 6 inches, where you pull 7 inches of brake, boom, it's spun or stalled. So there's a combination of things that are put together, and it happens over and over and over because of completely ignorant people out there trying to give advice and sending people to completely fake instructors and trying to pretend they're certified when they're not training people properly and not putting them on the proper gear. So if you've got a pig glider that doesn't handle very well, especially, and or it's not certified, and or you do not have certified height hook endpoints, and you're talking about someone who didn't even learn the most basic dynamics of how to properly control a glider, boom, it's just an accident waiting to happen, and it happens over and over and over. And everybody pushes their own personal limits, so pretty much everyone will run into it. Because it's kind of natural for people to start pushing more and more into what they're doing, and they start turning more and more, and you know, they want to keep getting better. And then they come to a point where you got uncertified height hook endpoints, uncertified class glider, they never learn the skills correctly, and boom, they spin the glider right out of the sky, crash, no crumple zone, boom. Spine hits first, and bam, you're dead. So if you spun out of the sky on like a flat top, which would be incredibly difficult, it's extremely difficult to spin a Dominator in flight, even if you're trying to do it. It's physically difficult. You'd have to take a wrap on the brake, bury the brake as hard as you physically can, and then hold it there for about 8 seconds to get that glider to stall or spin. They are incredibly spin resistant. But even if you spun it out of the sky, you got 18 inches of crumple zone on a flat top. Like, many of these people who broke their backs or died, it was because they're on a paramotor that has no crumple zone. Boom, they hit the ground with their spine, and it just doesn't take that much of an impact to your spine to break your back or kill you. So that's why competent pilots don't fly anything but a flat top. If you see someone who's not flying a flat top, straight away, you know they're either completely ignorant newbie or totally dishonest or completely incompetent. Friends don't let friends fly anything but flat top paramotors, specifically for hundreds of reasons, but two I just hit on mainly: certified height hook in points, tons of crumple zone under you, so even if you did pound into the ground, you've got huge impact protection, which can literally absorb a full stall. Three main pieces: pig piece of crap glider, didn't have certified height hook in points or a certified glider, and didn't have the correct paramotor that had certified height hook in points, and didn't have proper real training that trained them how to feel for that, feel where that pressure limit is, and practice the crap out of it on the ground until they simply stop spinning and stalling the glider on the ground, and learn how to feel for it to happen and then recover from it before it ever actually breaks into the spin. Now, that's another part. The recovery is a big part of why we fly Dominators, because a lot of gliders, if you break it into the spin, it just breaks and goes into it. Where a Dominator, you've seen this in other videos, but you bury the barracks, bury the brakes, and you try and make it stall, and the second it stalls, if you put your hands up, the glider will instantly recover and just forgive you for it. Where a lot of gliders, as soon as you broke it into the stall, boop, it just breaks, and you're pretty much screwed, and it's going to take, shoot, it could take 150, 300 feet to try and recover at a bare minimum, maybe even 1,000 feet to recover from that. And if you're 50 feet off the ground, boom, done. Or if you did it on a Dominator and you caught it, you can recover instantly, even though the odds of you spinning a Dominator are, yeah, you'd have to really, really try. It'd be very, very, I mean, I've tried to do it just by taking the brake and punching it as hard as I could. I couldn't get a Dominator to spin. So there's reasons the most experienced and competent pilots fly the gear that we fly, and there's massive experience behind it. It's not about a sales pitch, hey, buy this glider, because I can sell any glider on the planet. I mean, we carry over 200 different makes and models that we can sell. So I really don't give a crap. They're all about the same price. You say make about the same money. So it makes no sense to do anything but recommend the glider that I know is the best. Currently, right now, that's the Dominator. So stack the odds in your favor. There's absolutely no reason or excuse for these things to keep happening over and over and over and over. And the solution is to stop listening to people that don't know what they're talking about. You've got to do your research on who is an actual expert and who does training. Stop listening to fake organizations like the US HPA scam and the US PPA scam that are trying to pretend they're certified instructors. Totally fake. There's no certifications. You got to look at people that actually know what they're doing and are producing real actual pilots and, you know, creating skilled pilots on proper gear, which maximizes the odds in your favor. It's very simple, specific pieces as to why that happens with people that did not get flat tops and Dominators and did not get super training. So anyone could spin any glider if you try hard enough. It's all about the odds. The odds of doing it on a flat top and a Dominator with super training, if you graduate super training, the odds are like this big. And if you don't, you fly some horrible unit like a Nirvana or Scout or, you know, Blackhawk or Parajet, and an uncertified class glider, and you didn't get super training, your odds of doing it are basically almost 100%. Right in close. I mean, you factor in thousands of flights with people who just continue to push and push. It's going to happen because you're making it happen because you're just not doing things correctly. So it's like you think you're all great and you've been flying for 3 years and all of a sudden, boom, you fall out of the sky and die for the exact same reasons a total newbie did. It's the exact same thing. It just, he pushed a little harder on one flight and you took 400 flights before you actually did the same thing with the same results because you both had the same bogus wrong training and horrible gear. So it's very simple specifics. It's very frustrating because you see videos like that and it scares people away from the sport when it has nothing at all to do with the sport. Nothing. It's like watching someone crash a motorcycle and then thinking a Mercedes is unsafe because you saw someone crash a motorcycle. It's just not even the same thing. You get a certified glider with certified height hook endpoints and the safest paramotor, and you get the best training in the world, the odds are as low as they're going to get. If you don't do any of that, the odds are almost 100%. It's that simple. These crashes don't need to scare you. They should educate you of this is what you do not do. You do not listen to people that have no freaking clue. Instead, if learning from Mr. Magoo, you come take super training as you know you should do. So let this be a lesson to you and let's go flying and do it the right way.